Okay, I figured I'd do a little video about the shotgun again. I should do a full review on it, or I tried to shoot it years ago, but it has some problems with the firing pin. Like somebody filed it, so it's kind of pointy. So sometimes it has trouble setting off some types of primers, like the sort of domed shape ones and stuff. So I did fire it a couple times years ago, but I did a video on this about the straight rifling that it has. Some of the reasonings for it and stuff, but another sort of interesting thing about this one, like it's basically just a number one rolling block. It's in 16 gauge, so it has like the little sort of wing things on the side of the breech block and stuff. Like with the 20 gauge conversions, you could just convert like a 50-70 or the 12 mm Swedish rolling block. The military ones, they could just bore them out, and the block was big enough to cover the shell. But when you get into 16s and 12s and stuff, you have to put these wings on it, and then they usually have to cut these grooves in it so that the thing will go back to accommodate the thing. So, but anyway, it has this little lever thing inside of the hammer. It kind of looks like a, I don't know, clock trigger or something. See, and it pushes this little thing back, and see, that stops it from opening until you push that in. And that's more or less in case you get a punctured primer, which these seem to be quite, they seem to do it a lot. Like my 20 gauge one does it, and just because they have fairly strong hammers. Like if they were a military type action, had a pretty heavy spring on them. If you puncture the primer, it's theoretically possible to get enough gas to come back to drive the hammer back. And if that happens, the hammer comes back, and then this one, the action's kind of boogered up, but the breech would open on you, would blow open. That probably wouldn't be fun. So in some of their models, they had these locking hammers on them, which I don't know if this one actually had this originally or was put on it later, but because if you, I think I did a video about this years ago, but if you have like the old, a lot of the replica muzzlers, like 58s and stuff, and I think historically the ones actually built during the Civil War, the nipples on them were basically drilled straight through, or they were sort of a hourglass shape, sort of. They're bigger at the top and bottom, and they kind of constricted a little bit in the middle, but they still had a lot of blowback. Like most nipples you buy for muzzleloaders now, they have it's bigger on the top, and then it's like basically a pinhole, and they have a solid bottom on them. And but most of the old ones are basically straight through, which in my experience seems to be a reliability thing. Like a lot of the fouling that would get otherwise get trapped in the bolster would blows straight back. But if you overload them, like the military loads of the 58 muzzleloaders was like 60 grains or whatever, and it wasn't enough, or the American ones, it wasn't enough to actually blow the hammer back or beat it up too bad. But if you overloaded it like 3F or two more, or way more powder, and you had one of those straight through kind of nipples, it would blow the hammer. It could blow the hammer straight back to full cock, and a lot of them have similar kind of strength hammers as what these do. So if you punctured a primer on a shotgun shell, which a 16 gauge usually has about, with black, it's like 80 grains normally, or a 12 would have 100 or 110, somewhere around there normally. That'd be enough. I'm sure that's enough gas to probably drive the hammer back in a worst case scenario. So they did add these. So it must have been enough of an issue. Like they probably wouldn't put that on there unless it needed to be there. Same with like the firing pin extractors on some of the military models. The one where you open the breech, it would, there's a little thing on the back that would hit the hammer, and it would make sure the firing pin was to the rear, so that the firing pin wasn't corroded or stuck forward. So when you slam the breech block forward, it wouldn't, firing pin wasn't sticking out and set the case off. Because that would be the same, basically the same scenario. You'd have the gun would go off without the hammer being behind it and locked. The hammer would be you know, here. And you can only imagine if you opened it and the firing pin sticking out like that, and you go like that, set the shell off, it would just blow it open. Like, it would just, this one's a bit worn or something, but it would basically just blow this, like, open, and probably rupture the whatever was in there, like, so. But, I think with the smaller cartridges, I don't think it was such a big deal. It wasn't as much powder. It wasn't as such a, like, the 20 gauge ones that were built on the military actions. A lot of times you'll see the hammer, they had the nose of the hammer cut off, and it was right pointy on the end. And that was, I guess that was two reasons to, I think it stuck up too far that it got in the way of the shell when you, like, the longer, like, 2 3/4 or 2.5 inch, like, 20 gauge shell. And I think it would probably help with it. There was gas that came back. It would have less to push on, but I don't know if that's, because I know with, like, a lot of the 58 muzzlers in the old days, they had a cupped hammer on them. So if that came down and the gas came back, it's like a bowl. It's going to capture pretty much all the gas coming back. So it's, so, and I think that's why a lot of the old muzzleloaders, like replicas or the antique ones, a lot of times you'll see the hammer will be right jiggly kind of thing, like loose. Actually, I've got a couple myself that are like that. And I think that's just because of blast coming back that's battering the hammer. But like all the Italian, like, replicas, 58s I've had, I tried changing the nipples to the newer ones with the pinholes, and all they did was foul out and stop, and they got hang fires and stuff, where I went back to the old straight through or hourglass kind of shape nipples with the not solid base, and they never missed a beat. You had to put up a little bit of spray coming up, and it usually trying to eat the wood out just behind just the head of the hammer there and stuff. Because a lot of the old, like, Civil War muzzlers, you'll sometimes it eats the wood out so bad just behind the barrel and the head of the hammer there above the lock, you can actually see the lock, like, internals down in there. It chews everything out of there. But so that they kind of put up with that, I guess, just to get the reliability out of them, because they're, in my opinion, they'll plug up otherwise, unless they, especially with, like, the flat face breech blocks that a lot of the muzzle or the 58s had and stuff. If they got a patent breech, you can usually kind of get around that. They don't plug up as fast, but anyway, that's my experience with it anyway. So I'm sure other people have tried other things that they didn't have that issue, but I bought some of the new nipples with the small hole in them, and they were just annoying. I still got them, but I tried them, and I just stopped using them because it just caused all kinds of hang fires and annoyances. So I just put up with the bunch of stuff coming back. And use most 58s, you don't load them up ridiculous anyway, so it's not like it's a bad thing or anything. But you want reliability, basically, so. And a little bit of stuff coming, like, as long as you have some sort of eye protection on, a little bit of spray back from that's not end of the world anyway. And I shot flintlocks for a lot of years, and you get all kinds of garbage off of those. You know, you get powder stuff coming back, and chunks of the flint can come off, and that's why, like, at the, any kind of line shoots at black powder clubs, you're shooting on the line, you usually warn the guy that's to your right, because, or, you know, I guess there's left-handed flintlocks, but it's going to be crap coming out of it, unless you have one of those shields that they, guards that they put on, I think, some of them, for reenactment stuff, so the guy next to you doesn't get sprayed by all this junk, because a lot of stuff does come out, like black powder, I forget what the percentage is, but it, after it burns, it's a lot of junk left, like, it doesn't, you know, so a lot of that's coming out of there, and hot gas, and all kinds of stuff, so. But anyway, that's just something to think about. I found that it's kind of an interesting thing anyway, the little safety device on there. So it's kind of like the Glock trigger before it was a Glock trigger or something. But basically works the same. You gotta pull the little internal trigger to get the, or the internal part of the hammer to get the hammer to move. So anyway, thanks for watching, guys, and we'll talk to you later.